say anything I want. First thing I want to do is compare the two rifles in question. The trapdoor was made from 1873 to 1893, 20-year span at Springfield Arsenal, Springfield now. And they made about 555,000 of them, only at Springfield. Why did they need 555,000? I think we had Art Green telling us there was a standing army at about 25,000 or 5,000 cavalry. Well, they produced them because it was a large National Guard. The first 70 or 80,000 were issued and abused and used. So your first 75,000, if you find a really good early 73, Custer lost a bunch of them, everybody lost them. They turned out pretty bad shape. Later on, they made a lot of guns that never got issued. The 1888s, the 1884s. I can remember seeing Harold Young open crates of them and taking them out brand new years ago. Same at Bannerman's. So you'll find the 73s in pretty bad shape, 79, 84. The only reason I brought three examples down, one is a 73 carbine, because of the sight. It's got elevation and no windage. So at 200 yards, I have to hold off to the left of the target slightly and drop them in that way. 79, they were becoming more and more conscious of shooting, and they went to a site that had windage on it. And there's an example of that up here. Also at the same time, originally it came out at 4570 405. It was a 405 grain bullet, and they started to compete at longer distances, and it's 405 just disappears at over 400 yards. It has no really good ballistics. So about 1879 to 80, they really experimented, and they changed to a 500 grain bullet, and it was a much more accurate gun after that. In 1884, they came out with a Buffington rear sight, which is really a terrible battle sight, but a great target sight. As opposed to the 73, which is a V-notch, which was carried forth right into the Mauser of World War II. It had a V-notch, a great battle sight for acquiring a target and firing, and the Buffington was eventually burst into. If you look at a 1903 Springfield, it looks a lot like a Buffington sight. It's got the windage adjustment and all that type of stuff. So those are the variations of the rifle in 20-year period. Now let's look at the Martini Henry. Okay? Started out about 1871 and lasted until about 1889. Again, about a 20-year period. And it was popular with the British. They manufactured it, but they didn't manufacture it in one place. They manufactured it in three major manufacturing sites. Enfield, which was the Royal Arsenal, Birmingham Small Arms, and LSA, London Small Arms. And at their peak, they could manufacture 2,500 at Enfield a week, and 2,500 at Birmingham BSA, and 1,000 at LSA. LSA was in London, and it was limited by space. The interesting thing about them, though, they would trade, if BSA government wanted 10,000, they only had 7,000, Enfield would ship 3,000 barrels. So parts went back and forth between them. And generally, the finish inside and outside of the trapdoors was much higher quality, I think. I've gone through a lot of Enfields and a lot of different Martini Henrys, and inside, they're not quite as nice as the American guns were. Also, I made one though, and they a lot of independent manufacturers would get hold of receivers and make up rifles, like Field Rifle Company. There's a Daniel Fraser up here, which is a really top quality gun maker in Edinburgh, Scotland, that I'd love to shoot. It's an extremely accurate gun, and it's great. But there are two Enfields up here. So they would make up, they refer to them as private purchase guns. But they weigh about the same, and they're both 45 caliber. But that's where the similarity stops. Over here, you got 45 caliber, and it is a true 45 caliber. Three groove rifling, one turn and 22 inches. Nice, it's almost deeper at the base and a little tighter at the muzzle. And it's a true 45 caliber. Here's a 4.57 bullet. Although years ago we mic'd these things and they mic'd from 4.57 up to 4.62. So the government original bullets, which I've been shooting for years, that were pulled out of 1898 cartridges that came in that crate with pointer marks on them, they're slightly concave and they shoot great. 61 grains of Swiss powder. I've just shot crazy groups in the wall. Shot them out to 600 yards, actually, in my long range rifle. Now, you can get a 4570 cartridge case for about 48 cents. No big deal. Now we go to the Martini Henry, which is 45 caliber, but it's not the kind of rifling that we're used to. It basically has Henry rifling. It's referred to by Alexander Henry, a gunsmith again in Edinburgh, Scotland. And it's hard to describe. If you look down the barrel, the grooves are nice and shiny and smooth, and the lands are light. You look down and you say, oh, the bore is dark, but you see these shiny grooves and dark lands. I have a diagram of the rifling up here. It's hard to really describe it. And the difference is, at the breech, it's much larger. It has like an 11-inch forcing cone that squeezes the bullet down and brings it down to 45 caliber. So a lot of the people that load for the Martini Henry are loading 468 or 470 bullets or paper patch bullets. Now the original Martini Henry bullet was paper patch. They have an original coiled brass case. They were not extruded cases, they were coiled brass. It was cheap to make. You fired it, threw it away. That was it. But they would break off and they would hang up a little bit. So they went to a long lever with their Mark IV. They made four, Mark 1, 2, 3, and 4. But it has a longer lever for better extraction. And also, they made up extruded brass cases to ship overseas. If you're going into combat, you want the extruded brass case. You didn't want the coil brass. Although they made them for quite a while because it was cheap. Now, looking at it, it's a paper patch bullet. My experience with paper patch was back in 1981 shooting original Remington Creedmoor rifle. If you shot paper patch, you had to swap between every shot. And I found an original Remington manual, and it said for Creedmoor shooting, you must wipe or swab between each shot, or you'll get a large powder buildup forward of the chamber. So, why would the British use a paper patch bullet for a combat rifle? It didn't make any sense. But then I went back and researched how the British loaded their cartridges. And they basically, and this is a huge fat case, which you can see up here, compared to the 4570, it's a monster case. And they loaded it with 85 grains of black powder and a 475 grain bullet. So it was considerably more powerful than a trapdoor. But in there, they put a double card wad, and then they put a quarter inch of beeswax, and they refer to it as a grease cookie, another wad, and a paper patch bullet on top. So, okay, I went and I loaded a bunch up with paper patch with a quarter inch grease cookie with beeswax and some of my additive in there. I took it out and shot it, and lo and behold, it shot beautifully, one after the other. Boom, 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 no loss of accuracy. The grease cookie was the cure. And also, when you go to clean these things, it's black powder, two patches with G96, after shooting the grease cookies in it, came out beautiful, nice and clean. Stanman said that something about corrosive ammunition. I've been using G96 for years with black powder, corrosive ammunition, everything, and it just cleans it out perfectly. But I've never cleaned a black powder rifle that fast after firing these grease cookies. It's just much labor of grease down there. Now, the difference between the cases, though, is that's 48 cents. You go to buy a Jameson or Bertram Brass, which is made in Australia for these, $6 a case. That's about right. Yeah. Now, 48 cents is 100 shells from Brazil, and all the major dealers now stock them. And you start out with a brass shotgun shell, 24 gauge. You anneal it, heat it, quench it in water to soften it, trim it off, and run it through one forming die, then another forming die, and finally full length resize and trim again. And the basic case costs $1. The guy on the West Coast that sells these for 2 bucks. It's a heck of a lot cheaper than $6. So everybody's using the 24 gauge brass shotgun shells now. In regard to bullets, there are a lot of bullets available for the 45-70. You can buy a lot of different bullets. The original bullets that I have up here, you can take a look later, are slightly concave. So I had a bullet mold made with a concave base, which pumps up nicely into the board and shoots beautifully at any 45-70. So the only problem is with the Martini Henry. Guy on the West Coast also sells a plane-based bullet mold, 468 and 470. So it will fit in more on the Martini Henry, and it can switch down to 45 caliber as it goes down. I've had better luck using paper patch bullets than the Martini Henry. I got better groups consistently, and probably continue to use that for match shooting. But it's a lot of fun. The only difference is loading it. 45-70 is very easy. You load the powder, you load the card block, stick a lubricator bullet in, you're done. This thing, you gotta get that grease cookie in there, and I'm only using 60 grains in the case. It's a huge case, so I put some cream of wheat in to take up the filler, put my wad in, the grease, and the bullet. God bless.
God bless.
I brought two other guns, basically because these are all 1 in 22 twist, Martini Henry and the trapdoor. It's a Sharps Borchard that I picked up in May at the Allentown Gun Show as a parts gun. I cleaned the bore in it, took some of my 45-70 pull bullets, and shot a group like that at 50 yards. The target's there, it's blown up so it looks bigger. And I came home and I took a razor blade and scraped all the surface rust off the barrel, cleaned it lightly with fine steel wool. This is a keeper. I have to put the butt plate on. But the difference is the Sharps has six groove rifling, one turn in 19. And what we found experimenting was that in long range, the best twist for long range shooting black powder is 1 in 18. And I had a rifle that I built years ago for long range shooting, and it's up here, one of my favorites. One turn in 18 with a Badger barrel made by Ernie Stallman on an original high wheel action with a nice Sewell sight. That was the last one that guy in Pennsylvania made before he passed away. I just had it restocked and I shot that gun out to 1,000 yards. One turn in 18 was a 535-5 grain bullet. But I used 90 grams as well as the power of that. It's still 45-70, but I compress it. So that's about it. I wanted to give you a quick rundown. If you want to come up and ask questions later after dinner, put out the bayonets, the accessories that went with the guns, and some of the bullets that I use, and be happy to talk to you. Now, you want to shoot a trapdoor? You want to do a lot of shooting? Get a trapdoor. If you want to have a lot of fun, get a Martini Henry. Now, if you shoot these rapid fire, they heat up. But a Martini Henry really gets hot. I think it's that forcing pump, squeezing the bullet down. To the point where we shot the Victorian rifle match in September, you couldn't touch that barrel. It was just burning hot. But again, it's a lot of fun. If you put 85 grains, and I may try 85 grains in the springtime, you'll get a flame out of that thing that looks just great. And I didn't touch on any smokeless loading, because you can open any book and look for loads for smokeless. Well,
at that same match, I shot 82 grains. That's all I could get in the case successfully. Or I'll tell you, I won't ever do that again. That was a service load. Every time I shot, I moved back about 6 inches.
Well, I couldn't get it to the pro. position, and I used to shoot pole all the time. So I shot it offhand at 100 yards. I think it was 50 or 60.
Well, I shot it sitting because I knew Brown's was going to have guns. And my feet came up off the mat every single time.
Yeah, you're going to have the So if you want to have a lot of fun, trapdoors at the Allentown show a couple of weeks ago are down, price-wise. It's a very nice one for 5 days. I was surprised. The market is depressed. Conversely, Martini Henry market is going up. You can go to IMA and get a really nice one, an earlier one, but you're going to pay $1,000 for it. You get an untouched one for, I think, $650 or $625 or something like that. I went through a pallet and picked out 1, 2, 3, well, I picked out 10, narrowed it down to 3. If you're looking for rust on the wood line, a lot of them are rusty. So I picked them out based on overall condition. The bores are usually very good. IMA got 57,000 rifles out of this pallet in 2003. And probably a third of them were Martini Henry. The guy comes from England. He came to the shoot, and he buys, I think, in 5 years, he's bought 400 from IMA and shipped them back to England. They can't get them in England. And that pays for his trip back and forth.
What do you sell them for? What do you buy IMA selling them
for? It varies, depending on condition.
Yeah.
Now, it's hard to find the early Mark 1s or Mark 2s. They bring more of a premium. I saw one, and nothing was selling in Allentown, and I saw a guy pay $1,800 for a Mark 1. That was in good condition, but not great. And I was very surprised at that. Any quick questions? Because we've got Tom wants to.
What about the 5070, which was pretty popular with what, Custer and
I was trying to compare the 45-7 to the Martini, two 45 caliber guns here. And they lasted about the same amount of time. Now, I don't know how many they made, Martini Henrys. I've been trying to figure that out for like 2 years. Because Mark 1s, a lot of them are converted to Mark 2s. So, we don't know. And then a lot of Martini Henrys were converted to 303 later on. So you'll find that something Mark 3, and on the other side it says converted by BSA 303 in 1898. So we know they made 100,000 with Mark 4s. I think they made close to a million